the Bespoke Parenting Hour with Julie Gunlock and Cam Edwards.
Well, hello, Julie. It's good to talk to you again.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year. How were your holidays?
You know, they were good, actually. I was kind of surprised. It took me a little while to get into the Christmas spirit this year. You know, for whatever reason, it just didn't feel like Christmas and didn't feel like Christmas. And then finally, it was probably like Christmas Eve morning. I had some last minute shopping to do and was going around and all of a sudden the Christmas spirit hit. So I'm glad.
Yeah.
How about yours?
Oh, it was great. I have a lot of family in town and I do all the cooking. So which I love. It's fun for me to entertain for a bunch of people, make people happy and, you know, cook sort of the family traditions. So it was really nice. And now everyone's gone and the house is more quiet. The whole family went out, you know, sort of my husband took me out to dinner with the kids last night, so I didn't have to cook. And it was a really fun night with the boys. They're very well behaved. And so we've had a really nice, you know, holiday season. So it's been very nice.
That's really, really good to hear. I'm curious. I always ask this question of every parent. How late did your kids let you sleep on Christmas?
Okay, this is the thing. I get up at 5. I go downstairs because I have like a big breakfast buffet to make. So I go downstairs and I start prepping that. And, you know, I've got a strata to put in the oven, right? So I've got I've been sitting downstairs in the basement all night, you know, soaking in. So I've got a lot of prep to do. But the other reason I get up at 5 a.m. is because I'm like the elf in the movie Elf with, you know, like the enthusiasm of Christmas. I love Christmas. I get so excited after Thanksgiving. I love Christmas. And so when I was a kid, I would get my parents, we'd be opening presents at 5 a.m. So I have not changed. Mm. You know, I've not changed in my 40 some years. I get up so early and I'm desperate for people to get up. Okay. I insist. Now I have family that comes into town. My parents stay with us at the house. My sister and my aunt stay at a hotel down the road. I insist they be at my house. Well, last year I made them come to my house at 6:30 in the morning. I mean, can you bet? I'm horrible. That's horrible. But this year everybody protested. Everyone protested. And I was, you know, vetoed. And so they came at 7. Now I thought, oh my gosh, we're gonna have to sit around and wait for these people to get here. My kids slept until like almost 8 o'clock. I was so mad. I wanted everyone up. I want to get going. I want my presents. you know, I'm not one of those parents that complains about not sleeping in. I want everybody up. So I was up like a solid 3 hours before anyone else.
That's crazy. You were up 3 hours before we were. Because we had
what time did you get up?
We put down the 8 o'clock. We put down the marker for our youngest. Nobody wake anybody up before 8 o'clock. And the tradition at our house is you can get up, you can look at your stocking, you can open your stocking. You cannot touch any presents under the tree until everybody's
good,
up. Right. But that buys us as parents a good 30 or 45 minutes more sleep every Christmas morning. And so I think we were actually up a little bit before 8. And it was nice because, you know, our youngest are 11. Our oldest is 30. And so there's a really big spread there and everybody got along and none of the grownups were unhappy about having to get up early. Cause this is, you know, the kids are getting to the point now where Christmas definitely had its magic this year, which was awesome. But it's not going to happen every year. Not everybody is going to, is like you, Julie, where, you know, they're grown men and women and they're still getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I think that's awesome, by the way. I love that. But I want to appreciate this with my kids as long as I can. And maybe, I don't know, maybe I should just have my kids talking to you. And then they'll keep that Christmas spirit for years and years to come. I love the fact that you're up at 5 o'clock in the morning.
I'm so excited.
Of course, I don't live with you. So.
And I let my husband sleep. I crawl out of bed very quietly. You know, I might elbow him once or twice just to, like, you know, get the process started. But I don't, you know, I don't harass him to get up. And then I'm extra loud in the kitchen downstairs, hoping that my parents sleep in the basement. So I walk I sort of pound around trying to, hey, I'm up. It's time for you to get up. But no, everyone slept in. Most people got up around 6:30. And then we just kind of sat around and waited for the kids, which was only about another hour. It wasn't so bad. But we have actually, in years past, we have started opening presents while it's still dark out. And certainly when I was a child, my sister and I were both like this. We got them up very, very early. So anyway, so let's talk about some, we've been talking about very happy news, Christmas morning, how wonderful it is, the magic of Christmas. But we had some sad news over the weekend. Debbie Reynolds, since we last talked, Carrie Fisher died earlier in the week. She had a massive heart attack on a flight from London to LA. And sadly she had the heart attack right before landing, but so they were able to get rescue personnel to her fairly quickly, but she apparently never woke up. I guess slipped into a coma and never woke up and died a couple days later, maybe 2 days later after she had the heart attack. And then, tragedy on top of tragedy. Her mother, Debbie Reynolds, Hollywood royalty, I can't even throw out of time the list to all the movies that she has been in, but known as Tammy, Singing in the Rain, just an iconic figure. She died just yesterday. Apparently her last words, according to her son, Tom, were, "I want to be with Carrie." So just an incredibly sad story, out of Hollywood.
You know, it is. And it's sad, but at the same time, there's something that's very sweet and touching about that.
It is.
I read a story a couple of days ago about a couple, I think they're from Mississippi. They've been married for 64 years, and they died within a couple of hours of each other. He had been in the hospital, and then she was standing by his side, and then she ended up having, I think, an aneurysm and then passed away first. And then he just passed away a couple of hours later. And, you know, you see those stories and those, thank God, they get to you, you know. But, you know, Debbie Reynolds was 84. And it's hard,
good life.
I think, for any parent to outlive their kid, you know, that feels unnatural. My
especially
dad,
at that age.
His first, especially at that age, right. And so, you know, I think it's really awful, but I think what's really gotten me about this, both of these deaths, and particularly Carrie Fisher's, is all of a sudden now, Julie, we're being scolded that we're not grieving appropriately, or we're not remembering people appropriately. How dare anybody who was, you know, a hormonal teenage boy, recall Carrie Fisher as hot. Right.
Oh,
when
know,
they are remembering her attributes, and how dare Cinnabon post a picture of, you know, cinnamon buns, because we all remember the iconic hairstyle. Like, I'm so over this. Steve Martin.
Explain this. Steve Martin. What did Steve Martin do?
So Steve Martin tweets a couple of hours after Carrie Fisher dies that Carrie Fisher was a beautiful woman, and the first time he met her, he realized that not only was she a beautiful woman, but she was also very talented and very funny. And then some website says, deletes its account or whatever, right? Like, this is how dare you? Yes, this is awful. Apparently because Steve Martin said, you know, Carrie Fisher was an attractive woman and she had other qualities. I hate to break it to people, but, you know, Hollywood is sort of superficial. Julie,
it does tend to
run on attractiveness. Yes, Carrie Fisher, when she was 19, she was absolutely beautiful. So was her mom at 19. But that wasn't the point. It's not like Steve Martin was saying, well, you know, she was kind of a bimbo, but damn, she was good looking. Yeah, that was not his point at all. And yet, in this moment, we still have people who are trying to chastise each other. You're not grieving appropriately. You should have said that. I'm so done with it.
Yeah, well, this is the thing. I think you know that I was co-hosting with Cameron and John Pop yesterday on Cam and Company, and we brought this up. And by the way, you were very missed, on the show, and sort of I think everyone over there just sort of misses you there this week. But we had a lot of fun. We did have a lot of fun. I brought them in Christmas cookies, and there was a lot of laughter. I mean, my God, Cameron and John Popper. I say they're like the brothers I'm glad I never had. They like to razz me and give me a hard time, but we had a lot of fun. But you know, we brought this up, and I was talking to them about it, and I think there is a difference between the real world, how normal people respond to things like what Steve Martin said, that she was beautiful, but she was also witty and bright and very smart. And the people, I think normal people just kind of go, yep, that's nice, right? And then there's the Twitterverse, right? The Twitterverse, where people, where people look to be offended. They look for any crack, right? And I think sometimes our commentary is we're reacting to some Twitter outrage. But I think it's all fake. It's like Twitter's like fake news. It's fake outrage. And yet people respond to it like, you know, oh gosh, this is the way the world is going. I don't agree with that. I don't think most people, I think that people on Twitter reacted to Steve Martin like that because they all sort of get each other ginned up. But I don't think the real world reacts that way. I think that innocuous comment made by Steve Martin would have gone over just fine in the normal world, in normal conversation. Do you agree with me?
Yeah, I absolutely do agree with you. In fact, I was just thinking that last night that Twitter just is starting to remind me more and more of professional wrestling, where, you know, I don't want to say that it's staged and it's scripted because it's not, but you do have these sort of fake emotions. Like, who gets so upset at Cinnabon, right? Like,
if
you're the biggest Carrie Fisher fan in the world, and by the way, I mean, there weren't a whole lot of Carrie Fisher. Look, she was beloved, but it's not like people were walking around just randomly, you leave my girl alone. You know, like,
right?
No, that didn't happen. And yet now we're conditioned when we're online to, I think, look for outrage and look to be outraged.
Absolutely.
And I think the media is also picking up on this as well. The other forms of media, whether it's, you know, cable television, whether it's newspapers, they know that people like reading about outrage, you know?
Yeah.
In media, I think we are always looking to make that emotional connection with the audience. And the easiest emotional connection to make is anger. And outrage is a kissing cousin of anger, right?
Yeah.
I think a lot of this is laziness. It is laziness on the part of journalists. It's laziness on the part of us as consumers. If we want to be entertained, well, what's the easiest way? Well, let's just go get angry. Let's go, you know, who's being stupid? Who said something awful? I'm just kind of tired of it. I really am.
I am tired of it too. And I write about sort of these, the how outrage or fear or anger leads to really bad policymaking, and especially when it comes to parenting. You know, and on the show we talk about how, you know, you should really, you know, not totally tune out the parenting experts, but you should really create a parenting strategy that works for you and your kid, and don't just try to, you know, do everything that the experts say. Also I think you need to be skeptical about people who call themselves experts. You know, there are a number of mommy blogs that have said on multiple occasions that I'm poisoning my children by ever giving them any processed food. Well, you know, when I get the kids home and they have a baseball game and a scout meeting and I have to go to a PTA meeting, I am going to put frozen Dino Nuggets in the oven along with some Orida tater tots, and that's what they're going to get for dinner, because I don't have time to go out to the garden, you know, to harvest some sort of carrots and then bring them in and wash them off and, you know, braise them along with a roast. I mean, I don't have time for this, right? So a lot of these sort of, you know, mommy bloggers and parenting experts sort of forget that life happens and life gets busy. And so, but it's not just that kind of stuff that I talk about. You know, we also talk about the policies. You know, this is, and I, you know, I'm connecting this to the Twitter rant, is that this, I don't want to dismiss the fact that this outrage, these quick-tempered reactions, it is starting to seep into policy. And for instance, I saw this article just yesterday. And what's so interesting about this is the LA Times, okay? The Los Angeles Times isn't exactly a conservative newspaper, okay? Conservative-leaning newspaper, okay? And they certainly aren't even... they love government solutions to things, right? So the LA Times generally, like, if there's a problem, the only solution is government, okay? So that tends to be where their editorial board comes down. But shockingly, the LA Times editorial board is in opposition to this new proposal that the LA City Council is going to propose, it hasn't been voted on yet, but the LA City Council has proposed a ban on single adults sitting near playgrounds. Okay, so let me explain that, because that can get confusing. It's like, if you are, for instance, my dad, if my dad goes for a walk in the morning through a park and he wants to sit on a park bench in front of a playground and watch and take a rest and maybe eat a donut or read the newspaper, and there is a playground nearby, he would get ticketed. A police officer could come over to him, say, have you brought a child here? Are you here to watch one of your own children? If the answer is no, he would be ticketed and asked to leave the premises, okay? Or if my sister, or if you, you know, if let's say you are away from your kids, you have kids, but you're away from the kids for the day. Okay?
Yeah.
So no single adult without a child can go and sit on a park bench to play chess, to eat a donut, to even watch the kids. You know, kids are really fun to watch, especially when they're not your own. Okay. It's fun to watch the dynamic.
As you're telling me this story, so we've got a listener on Cam and Company, and I've known him. I've actually never met him, Julie, but I've known him for over a decade now. And his daughter died when she was younger. And he's an older guy now. And I could see him as the type of person who, you know, on a Sunday afternoon would be like, I just would like to be around people, you know, and I'd like to, there are a million reasons, innocuous reasons, why somebody without a kid would sit down at a bench, right? or sit down near a playground without it being, oh, they're perving out watching the children, right?
Yeah.
Let's go book them, Dano. This is a ticketable offense.
This is, and actually, Kim, I'm glad you said that, because I didn't really explain further. The councilman who proposed this, he said it is specifically to cut down on creepy behavior. So apparently watching children, enjoying the laughter of children, is creepy behavior. And what this suggests is every single person is a pedophile. Okay. Now,
yeah.
O'Farrell is this guy's name, this councilman's name. O'Farrell said he was inspired to propose the ban after residents in Hollywood complained that their local park had been taken over by drug dealers. Hello, dealing drugs in a public place is already a felony. Okay.
Illegal.
It's illegal. Like just enforce the laws already in the books. Okay. And he says that is the real problem. This is the editorial board. It says if that is a real problem, and by all means, the city should crack down on illegal activity in playgrounds. But that's drug dealing. I mean, you know, you're going to, and also O'Farrell says that this was also inspired because other cities are doing this. New York City. Where the police caught, I'm reading from the editorial, where police caused a minor uproar several years ago by ticketing people for sitting on a playground adjacent benches to eat donuts or play chess. Now, I mean, you know, this is, I'm writing an opinion piece on this right now. They talk about the movie Minority Report, right, where precogs are able to look inside people's minds and figure out who's going to, right? Well, at least they were able to look into people's minds and see what they were going to do. They're not even, this is worse than Minority Report. They're just assuming everybody is a pedophile who, you know, wants to lure children or watch children, take photos of them. You know, it's not even, it shouldn't even be illegal. If you want to take a photo of a child playing a playground, I don't really think that's the worst thing in the world either. I mean, it might creep people out, but you know, this is just insanity. And you know, again, it's really interesting to see that the LA Times has come against it. It shows you just how inappropriate this proposal is. When the lefty, you know, government-loving, government-solution-loving LA Times is against it. There's another story.
Well,
go on.
Yeah, well, I was just going to say, you know, maybe that's a sign of hope that there is a bridge too far. You know, even for organizations like the LA Times, like there's something that they can see and they, as nanny state loving as they are, they're, you know, everybody's got their line that they won't cross. And apparently, you know, this is it for the LA Times. I'm glad that let's work on maybe expanding this line of thought and maybe the LA Times
is going
to start to realize some of this other stuff is stupid too.
Yeah. So there's another story. Our friend Lenore Scanese, always on top of these ridiculous stories. She wrote just yesterday, a 5-year-old boy accidentally walks to school on Saturday. Cops arrest dad. Okay, and this is part of the hit and run blog on Reason.com. She writes for Reason and as well as her own blog at freerangekids.com. But so I'll read you a little bit of this. So the 5-year-old in Berwick, Pennsylvania, woke his dad up early on a Saturday morning and said it was time to go to school. Daddy told him no, it's Saturday, no school, and went back to sleep. Now the dad, Jeffrey Wagner, German Wagner. Anyway, Jeffrey Wagner, I don't know what's wrong with me, is facing child endangerment charges. Unbeknownst to him, his son continued to get ready for school and ventured out into the chilly day to make his way to the bus stop. Oh, my God, what a sweet little boy. Of course, no bus arrived, so the determined little boy started to walk to school. He must love school.
Right.
Started to walk to school. And then, reports CBS Pittsburgh, a motorist spotted him and called police, who picked up the boy. Wagner waived a preliminary hearing Thursday and will face the charge in county court. she goes on to talk about this is, you know, because, of course, only the children of criminally negligent parents ever do anything unexpected, right? I mean, God, Lenore's so great on this stuff. I mean, this is the thing. You and I talk about this all the time. We talk about how sometimes schools will do something we think is unreasonable, like ban this or ban that. And then we're hard on the school officials, like, what is wrong with them, right? Mm-hmm. And it come to find out, parents have demanded it, right? Or sometimes the schools just really are unreasonable. And in this case, this is one of these cases where I'm like, did common sense ever come into this? Did the police at any point take a deep breath and say, is this really worth an arrest? You know, you have to this guy is now facing charges. You know, some district mm-hmm. attorney is going to charge this guy. Like, at what point is a grown-up walking in the room and saying, either to the police or the prosecutor, and saying, hey, guys, maybe we need to back this up a little. Okay, this was a mistake. This kid was eager. I mean, parents are allowed to sleep in the morning. You know, you tell your kid, nope, go back to, you know, go play with your toys. I do it all the time. Go play with your toys. I'll be down in a little mm-hmm. bit. This is just unbelievable to me that it's gotten this far.
I would imagine, you know, and not being in possession of all of the facts, I would imagine that even on the police force, there are probably some officers, probably quite a few, who are thinking, is this the best way to have handled this? Is this the really appropriate mm-hmm. resolution? Mm-hmm. And it kind of makes you wonder, you know, what we don't know yet, either
right.
about the officers or about the dad, and, you know, whether I don't know. We just don't know. But you're right. On the face of this is one of those moments where you think to yourself, what on earth, are you guys doing here? First of all, if that was the standard, then my parents would absolutely have been arrested. I know that we've talked about this before, but right after we moved as a family to Oklahoma and I was like 2 years old, I got out of our backyard with our new puppy dog and was found about a mile away walking down the center median of a 4-lane road. And these very nice ladies saw what was going on and they pulled in behind me and I was crying because I had no idea where I was because I was lost. And the dog that we had picked up just a few weeks ago actually ended up walking us back, leading the way back to our house.
No way.
Yes, totally. Best dog ever. But if that had happened today, my parents would have been thrown in the clinker, right?
Absolutely.
They absolutely would have been arrested. They absolutely would have been charged with child negligence or child endangerment. And you know what? I had good parents. My mom loved me. She cared about me. She was a great mom. But things happen. There are moments, right, where
right.
you think your kid is where they are. And if your kid has never, ever in their life gotten up on a Saturday morning and said, no, I don't believe you, Dad. I'm going to school, gotten dressed, headed out of the house. I guarantee you a sleepy father is not thinking that this is going to happen, right?
Yeah.
It's just not. You cannot predict everything.
Yeah. You know, I've never, ever told this story on air. I've never, and I actually, very few people know this story because it's so horrifying. I had all the boys playing in the backyard and we had padlocks on the gates, little padlocks that needed a little key that I always had on my key ring. And but we'd had a 2 days earlier, we'd had the exterminator come to the house, and he always sprays the back. So I had left the gate open. I'd locked the other gate, but for some reason, the side gate did not get did not get closed. And all the boys were in the back playing, and my little Willie, who was only he was under two, he was walking, but he was not quite two yet. So probably I don't know, 18 months. And he had this little mower that would help him balance as he walked around, and he was mowing the yard, and his other brothers were playing in the, you know, all my children are really close in age. So they're all really little at this point. Well, I also happen to live on a very busy street. I live in a residential neighborhood, but I live on one of the main, sort of veins in Alexandria. Mm-hmm. It's a really, really busy road. And he took his little mower and he decided to mow the front yard, and he mowed all the way down the driveway. And I mean, this people go 40 miles an hour on this road. They are so fast. They never slow. It's 25 mile an hour limit. Nobody pays attention. And it was sunset. The sun was setting. And so the sun was in the driver's eyes, and thank God Willie almost went into the street and a car. I was in my house. And I would, you know, I'd peek out the windows every once in a while, make sure they were okay. All of a sudden, I heard the screech. I heard the screeching tires. And I was like, what is going on? And so I looked out I only saw two kids. And I don't know what I thought, but I just wanted to see. I thought, oh, I can't see him. He must be in a corner somewhere. But I decided to open the front door and see what was going on. And there was an SUV, and Willie was... He was not in front of it, but he was his little mower was in the road. He was still in the driveway, but barely. And a man came screeching to a halt, and he was out of his, and it was this big man looking at Willie, and Willie had just had a smile on his face. He didn't realize what was going on. Anyway, the point is he could have gotten hit, and this man was horrified. Now, of course, I run out, I scoop Willie up, I bring him in the house, and the man was just startled. And I said, I'm so sorry. He got out, you know, and I think about that sometimes because it was a terrible accident on my part. And from then on, every time they went out into the yard, I walked out of my house and checked the locks. So I made sure every time I was like completely you know, obsessed with those locks at that point. But, you know, I thought about what if that man could have been so upset at what I had done and thought I was such an irresponsible parent that I could have gotten a visit from social services. I could have gotten a visit from the police officer. And I think about that. Look, you know me, I'm pretty honest about other parenting failures and mistakes. But I just think in our day and age now, and that was, you know, that was about 4 years ago. You know, where are we going now where parents aren't allowed to make mistakes? And sometimes parents make terrible mistakes. You know, they make mistakes when they leave their kids in the car, they leave, you know, on a hot day, they forget, you know, and, you know, but, and in many cases, those parents, they do deserve some sort of punishment, but, you know, I just think we are becoming unforgiving, very, very much unforgiving on parenting and parenting mistakes. And I think this case of this dad whose child walked to school on his own. You know, again, we don't know all the details, but it's pretty astonishing that this man is literally facing charges now for his little boy walking to school. The kid was five. I mean, he was not two. It looks like he got ready, you know. And so I find the lengths that the police and prosecutors are going to be very frightening. It's frightening, and it's frightening for parents like me who, I mean, frankly, I make a lot of mistakes.
Well, and as you say, I thought it was really, it was a word that you used there when you talk about how we're becoming more unforgiving. And, you know, it's happening at the same time, Julia, that fewer and fewer people are having kids.
Yeah, why would you?
So I kind of wonder how much of the unforgivingness is actually coming from people who aren't parents. Right.
Yeah.
And who don't want kids and who maybe have had bad experiences growing up. Maybe they're angry at their parents for whatever reason, because, you know, we all want trophies and therapy now. I think you're right, though. I think that they're, you know, look, obviously there are parents out there who are capable of doing awful things to their kids, things that would just break your heart and absolutely terrify you. We understand that. But on the spectrum of things that parents do to their kids, you know, sleeping while your kid quietly gets dressed and goes to school, I don't consider that child abuse.
No.
I don't. Making a mistake and forgetting to, you know, check that the gate is locked, whether it was,
a couple of years ago
or my mom in 1978. Those things happen.
Yeah.
Those things
they're
happen.
They're suggesting
now,
that this guy is criminally negligent. I mean, the idea like, that this guy, like, you know, is negligent, doesn't care about his little boy. Like, there's just no room for you as a parent. You better be pretty damn perfect. You know, there's no, it's no mm-hmm. longer you've made a mistake. You are criminally negligent. There's a total difference there. And so, you know, I just find it. Parenting is still trial and error. You do your best, but, you know, not everyone's perfect. No one's perfect. I mean, you know, even thinking about, you know, gosh, I watched some videos yesterday of Debbie, Carrie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds and their relationship. And clearly, you know, Carrie Fisher did not have this iconic childhood. There were lots of mistakes and, you know, you could see it in their more, you know, their later relationship. They were still working through the issues that they had as, you know, as mother and daughter. And so, you know, I'm not surprised when I see fewer and fewer people having children. Why would you? Why would people? It's a tough job and it's a thankless job. And then if you make a mistake, you know, you could be going to jail. So it's not surprising at all to me.
Well, and to bring it full circle, you know, again, with this outrage culture that we started off talking about, these stories, I think, fit in a couple of ways. First of all, from our perspective, these are the stories that we get outraged by, right?
Yeah.
So this is like our red meat. We see a dad who's getting charged for, you know, sleeping in while his kid gets dressed and goes to school. I get angry about that, right? But I think the only reason, you know, again, why this guy got arrested is probably because the cultural push right now is, can you believe this guy did that? That's awful. What kind of parent does that, right? And so the expectation is, well, we got to do something. We got to do something about this type of behavior. And it's that type of outrage against, you know, parental mistakes where you're not, as you say, you're expected to be perfect. You're not allowed to make any mistakes. The outrage that ensues when, you know, people publicly have a parenting fail. Right. And maybe it's embarrassing and Christmas. Now, all of a sudden, it's a criminal case. It's not just an embarrassing moment because we are living in that outrage fueled culture. And these stories can pop up. And all of a sudden, you know, Julie, if you had had you wrote about leaving your kids in the car for a couple of minutes and the FBI agent coming and, you know, rah, 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 right.
Holding me.
Can you imagine? You got a lot of attention for that story.
Yeah.
Can you imagine how much exponentially worse it would have been had someone had a smartphone and was recording this interaction with you?
Well, I tried to. It's so funny that you say that because I often scold my children and I put the hammer down. My kids, you know, it's interesting to me. Sometimes I just posted on Facebook a picture of my children. We got some family photos done, right? Like the typical, like, oh, aren't we perfect? Everything's great. We're all happy. Like, if you look really closely at my children's faces, there is terror in there behind those smiles. Okay. Absolute abject terror behind those smiles. And this is so weird. So, because basically I was giving them the stink eye behind the photographer. I was standing behind the photographer and I was like, you better freaking smile. Right. And it was not, I'm not like a sweet mom. Like I'm pretty tough and I've got boys. So like, that's the way I parent boys. Right. So you know, on Facebook, everybody's going, oh, what a lovely family. Oh, you're all so happy. And I was like, it's hilarious because really during that day, I was like, and I distinctly remember saying to them, gathering them and saying, like, just be normal for 15 minutes. Just act like a normal child and smile, right? Which is really not normal, like to be so good and smile like that. But anyway,
right.
Many people commented, like, I can't get a picture of my children anymore. And I'm like, really? Like, it's not that hard. You just like threaten to take away things they love, right? or they'll have to sit in there. I mean, like, have you tried punishment? Like, I will tell them, like, you're going to go to your room when you get home. You're going to spend a significant amount of time in your room, or you know, I'm going to take away your game. They get, I'm very strict about technology, but sometimes I let them have a little bit of time on their DS. And so, you know, I'll take that away, or I'll take something else away. And so, you know, no food for a week. I'm kidding. But, you know, so I don't understand this. Like, that's, you gotta be a little tough, but I sometimes want, I think, man, if anybody catches me, right, like videotapes me saying something like "be normal for 15 minutes" or "smile or else," you know, I'm in trouble. And so, yes, on that day, I tried to videotape that FBI guy. I was going to videotape the entire interaction, but my phone was dead. But in some ways, it's probably better because I wrote about it. You know, I probably came off much more sensible and calm. He probably came off worse than he was in my writing of it. So, but yeah.
So you say better. You mean better for you?
Yes, probably better for me because I was ranting at that guy to get away from. I mean, I kind of went a little bit crazy because he was standing near my car, freaking my. He was the problem. He was freaking my kids out. And so, you know, I went a little bananas. So I probably wasn't as articulate as, you know, later after I calmed down and I wrote it down. I only wrote it down a couple hours later. So it was still fresh in my head. But, you know, you always sort of write yourself a little better than you actually were. So probably better for me.
Well, just keep the, see, and another reason just to not worry about social media, not worry about this stuff. Just let your phone's battery die. Right. Yeah. And then you get to tell the story your way.
That's right. That's right. Well, look, we're coming up here on our limit, but just really quickly, are you staying in? What do you guys do for New Year's?
Yes, we are staying in. We were planning on having a small party, and then we developed a leak in our downstairs toilet, the only toilet that's not attached to a bedroom. And so we need a new toilet. And so now we are on a quest to get a new toilet installed before New Year's Eve, because otherwise our small little holiday gathering goes away.
But
our family tradition is to always have, we have like frozen food night. So we'll go to the store, right? We always talk like farm to table, that I make my own. Yeah, this is the night of the year, Julie, where it's like, all right, let's get the TGI Fridays potato skin. Let's get right. We just load up with taquitos and frozen pizza and wings, and we just have a fast food frozen food feast. We watch movies, we play games with the kids, and it's a good time. Yeah,
that's great.
What about you?
That's wonderful. We usually get a babysitter and go out and do a whole bunch. We go to a bunch of different parties, we grab dinner, we have a whole sort of night out, just the two of us. But this year, we're going to actually take our children to one of the parties. It's a neighborhood party. We go every year, and every year we see some of the kids there that they go to school with, and it's a really lovely party up the road. This sort of lovely family. They have this big house, and they have this big party, and so we're going to actually take the kids this year, and then come home and watch a movie and let the kids stay up till midnight. They're older now, so you know, my youngest is 6, so we'll let them stay up and see the ball drop. It'll be fun.
Awesome. Well, have a very happy new year. I look forward to many, many more Bespoke Parenting Hour podcasts in the year ahead.
Yes. 2017. Can't believe we're here, but we are, and we will continue our podcast into the new year, into 2017 and beyond. And it's been a great year. I always love chatting with you, Cam. So, and thanks to all of our listeners for tuning in to the Bespoke Parenting Hour. You can check our previous podcasts at IWF.org. They are all there. And so happy New Year, Merry Christmas from us to you.